So I think the conference has been amazing. I mean, it's just been incredible. God has spoken through every person. And what I just want to remind you of is that when God speaks, He creates. This is the way He creates. You never ever see Him waving His hand, you know, to create the sun or the moon or the stars. Read Genesis 1, then God said. Those three words, then God said. So whatever God said to you through Darius or Joachim or Preston or Charlotte or through Michael or through one of the worship pastors or through me, whatever God said, when He said it, the power to fulfill the word is in His word. So I want you to know, when the enemy tells you, when you go home and he tells you you're not different, you just need to know that's a lie. Because you are, because God spoke something to you, and that seed is going to grow and God will complete it. And so you need to know that. So I'm going to share something tonight. I told you the other morning, I think about 10 years ago, maybe 11, I shared about the Jezebel spirit. I called it Stop Tolerating the Jezebel Spirit. And God has just used in that message. And the reason is because I believe the number one spirit that attacks leaders is the Jezebel spirit. Now, I want you to know that the enemy will throw any wrench up to get you to not hear this because he doesn't want you to, he doesn't want to be exposed. There's nowhere in the Bible where the three words, the Jezebel spirit, appear together, okay? So you have, you know, God has not given us a spirit of fear. But there's nothing about the Jezebel spirit. There's an Old Testament woman named Jezebel and a New Testament woman named Jezebel. And from that is what I'm drawing, that I believe, I'm calling it the Jezebel spirit, but I believe there's a spirit that attacks leaders. That spirit attacked Elijah in the Old Testament, and then that spirit was attacking leaders at the Church of Thyatira. So that's where we're getting this from, all right? And when I started writing the message, I wasn't thinking about the five W's and the H of journalism. If any of you have ever had a journalism class in high school or college, I had a journalism class. And when you write an article, you're always supposed to include the five W's and the H. You know, what happened, when did it happen, where did it happen, why did it happen, and what, when, where, why, who. Yeah, and actually, grammatically, it's to whom did it happen. But anyway, and then how. How did it happen? So I wasn't doing that at all in my mind, but I just began to write, you know, whom does this spirit attack, and when does this spirit attack, and where and how. And then I realized I was just, you know, the Lord was just leading me with the five W's and the H, even though they're not in order. That's kind of the way we're going to take it, right? So, Revelation chapter 2, Jesus appears to John. He appears in John 1, and the whole book of Revelation is a letter. Many of the epistles, and this is what the word epistle means, letter. It doesn't mean the wife of an apostle, but it's just a letter. So this, the whole book of Revelation is a letter to the seven churches of Asia Minor, the whole book. And all you got to do is read John chapter 1. Jesus said, write what you see and send it to the seven churches, all right? And so we'll talk about that. The seven churches, I believe it was written to the seven churches because they were on the most populous trade route of the day. John is exiled to the island of Patmos because he won't die. That's the you know, Tertullian recorded this in history. The Bible doesn't tell us, but historical writers record this. They put him in boiling oil, and he kept preaching to them. And so they put him on the island of Patmos. And then he writes the book of Revelation after he'd written 1st, 2nd, 3rd John and the Gospel of John. I decided to just show you a little map just to show you the seven churches and Patmos. There's Patmos, the island. And then if you start at Ephesus and you go clockwise, like let's say that's 9 o'clock and then you go up, then you got Smyrna, Pergamum, Thyatira, Sardis, Philadelphia, and Laodicea. And that's the way that that's the order of the seven churches in Revelation 2 and 3. And I believe Jesus did this because he wanted this letter, which includes, again, the whole book of Revelation. You have to understand that. He wanted it to go on this populist trade route, and then he wanted it to go back to the port at Ephesus and then go to other places in the body of Christ and then be a part of the canonized scripture. So that gives you just a little background. So the fourth church is the church of Thyatira. And in all the churches, by the way, since we have so many preachers here, it's hard to see in two of the churches, but there is a commendation. I know what you're doing well. Then there's a correction, but this is what you're doing wrong. And then there's counsel. He even says in one of them, I counsel you, you know, to buy from me. And then in some of them, then there is a crown or a reward. This is what's going to happen for those who overcome. And of course, he says, be of good cheer, I've already overcome the world. So in Christ we overcome. So so let me show you that in Thyatira, he addresses this Jezebel spirit. Now I'm gonna also tell you something that I might do that I hardly ever do in a message. And that is, I might actually read some of the message. And the reason is because as I've been going over it, I've been reading some of the things that I've written, and I'm surprised. I think, did I write that? And so I just feel like it needs to be said this way. And I also think you should listen to the message several times, not because I'm the vehicle, but because the Holy Spirit is saying that this is the most important attack leaders face, is the Jezebel spirit. I was asked that in an interview a while back, and they said, what's the most difficult attack you've ever faced? And I immediately said the Jezebel spirit, and I faced it several times. So Revelation 2, we'll start there. This is where he begins talking to the church at Thyatira, and to the angel of the church in Thyatira write, these things says the Son of God, who has eyes like a flame of fire and his feet like fine brass. Let me just say one thing I didn't say. Every word in Revelation 2 and 3 is in red, if you have a red letter edition. So every word Jesus spoke. So this is pretty amazing. And by the way, this is 65 years after the resurrection. 5 years after the resurrection, Jesus appears to Saul, whom we know as Paul. 65 years later, he appears to John. So it's a pretty important book here. Verse 19, I know your works. Here's the commendation. Love, service, faith, and your patience. And then this is an amazing statement. As for your works, the last are the more than the first. That's just, man, that's really good to hear from Jesus. You know, I mean, you're getting better at what you're doing. Nevertheless, so here comes the correction. I have a few things against you. Now, I want you to realize that I look grammatically at every passage. So he says things, which is plural, but we think it's one thing, and that's Jezebel, but it's not. It's Jezebel causes many things. When you allow a Jezebel spirit in your congregation, then many things become the result, and we'll talk about that. So I have a few things against you because you allow that woman, Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess. When people tell you their office or their gift, beware. Because if they really are, they don't have to tell you. See, Michael doesn't have to tell me he's a comedian. I can figure that out, you know? Michael Bethany doesn't have to tell me he's a worship leader. I can figure that out. When someone has to tell you, his or her gift or office, beware. Okay, now I'm not saying the person has a Jezebel spirit. What I'm going to try to make clear is that there's a person that has an open door, and that spirit then will come in through that open door. And that open door, just to go ahead and let you know, is insecurity. So when a person has to tell you their resume, you need to get your eyes open, okay? All right. Who calls herself a prophetess to teach, you allow her, okay, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality and eat things sacrificed to idols. So we're going to talk about immorality and idolatry are two manifestations of a Jezebel spirit operating in a church. And I gave her time to repent. I just want you to notice there's a person involved that Jesus loves, and he gives people time to repent, but she didn't repent. I gave her time to repent of her sexual immorality, and she did not repent. Indeed, I will cast her into a sick bed. This is a manifestation of the Jezebel spirit. And, now this is very important, those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation. In other words, if you allow her to operate in your church, you're going to have great tribulation. Unless they repent of their deeds. So let's get to the points here. Number one, whom does the spirit attack? Leaders. Leaders. Elijah was a leader. It's the first time we ever have a mention of a Jezebel. He is speaking to leaders. And the reason we know he's speaking to leaders, every letter begins with to the angel of the church of. Okay, the Greek word for angel, you probably know all this, is angelos. It means messenger. There are some people who believe that there is an angel over every church. There's no scriptural evidence for that, that every church has an angel watching over it. There's just no evidence for that. Most theologians believe that he's speaking to the pastor of the church. Matthew, Mark, and Luke call John the Baptist a messenger, and they use the word angelos, and yet he's a man. John, if you remember, is having an angel show him around in the vision, and then in Revelation 22, verse 8, now I, John, saw and heard these things, and when I heard and saw, I fell down to worship before the feet of the angel who showed me these things. Then he, the messenger, the angel, said to me, see that you do not do that, for I am your fellow servant. Now watch this. And of your brethren, the prophets. So the angel that's showing him around is not an angelic being. He's a messenger from God, and he says, I'm one of your fellow servants. And then he even makes this statement, I'm one of your brothers. And then he makes this, I'm one of the prophets. I'm simply saying that it is possible, if you have a different belief, that fine, it's okay. But I believe to the angel of the church of is to the pastor or to the leader of the church. By the way, the pastor would have gotten up and read the letter, not some angel. So he's writing to the pastors of the church. Are you following me? These angels are told, we're told that they're stars. Revelation 1 verse 20, the mystery of the seven stars which you saw in my right hand and the seven golden lampstands. Now watch this. The seven stars are the angels of the seven churches, and the seven lampstands which you see are the seven churches. So two comments. The church is a lampstand. So I want to say this. We're not the light, but we hold the light. Jesus is the light. And you don't light a lamp and put it under a basket. You put it on a lampstand. And when he talks about coming and removing your lampstand, he said, you are not being a good example of the light, so I'm not going to let you shine very brightly in your city. Because I don't want people to think that's what the light looks like. So that's one. But then he says, the stars you saw in my right hand. Now, this is so powerful, I don't have time to develop, but you need to get very excited. If you're a pastor, you have been engraved on the palm of Jesus, your name. The seven pastors, messengers you saw are in my hand. And let me give you another scripture that shows you this. Daniel 12, verse 3 says, those who lead many to righteousness will shine like the stars forever. So again, we're comparing the stars. Now, again, notice the word lead. So let me say this. I'm speaking to the pastors, but let me speak to all of you because all of you are leaders. Leaders are in his hand. Now, you say, well, I'm not even a leader, all right? John 10, 28 says, my sheep nor in my hand. Nobody can pluck them out of my hand. So we're all in his hand. So it's a pretty good place to be. And then he says, you're also in my Father's hand. Nobody can get you out of his hand either. So it's good to be in his hand. So to whom does the Jezebel spirit attack leaders? Here's number two. Why does the Jezebel spirit attack leaders? Well, we just read it. Because leaders lead many to righteousness. Satan is a strategist. So if there's a person who's going to lead 10 people to Christ over his lifetime, and there's another person who's going to lead 10,000 to Christ, whom do you think he's going to attack the most? Satan is smart. He is smart. I mean, he's evil, but he's smart. So he is going to attack a leader. And the larger your church grows, the more the Jezebel spirit's coming after you. I promise you. So he attacks leaders. Again, Elijah was the first that we know of. And let me tell you three things that God entrusts leaders with. He entrusts leaders with anointing, resources, and influence. Anointing, resources, and influence. And the more you can handle, and you don't get excited. In other words, you get up on stage, you get the anointing of God, you get prideful, he's going to take it back. He's not going to let you be anointed. The more resources he gives you, and the more you don't handle those, steward those resources right, he's not going to let you handle more resources. To whom is faith, whoever's faithful with little will be faithful with much. Okay? And then the other thing is influence. Now, let me give you three words that attract people who have an opening in their life that the Jezebel spirit could come in. So I'm telling you, God gives leaders anointing, resources, and influence. Let me tell you to this insecure person what he sees. Respect, money, and fame. The Jezebel spirit is genderless. It's male or female. He or she wants respect, money, because that's power, and fame. That's acceptance. That's the open door that he has. Insecurity, inferiority, fear. So all he does is look at a leader who has it, and he or she, again, so let me just use the masculine, and you but know that it's a he or she. The Jezebel spirit I've dealt with in my life has always been through a man. But he sees the anointing that you have or the respect that you have, and he craves that. He sees the resources that God's given you, and he has to struggle for everything he gets. Here's a tip-off to a person who has an open door to a Jezebel spirit. I've had to work for everything I have. And I've had literally people say to me, Pastor Robert, I've had to work for everything I have. Everything you have has been given to you. And you know what I say? Uh-huh. And Jesus said the very same thing. All authority has been given to me by the Father in heaven. And people will say things like, well, Pastor Robert, you just were in the right place at the right time, but I've had to work for everything I get. Well, that right there is a sign to me that they don't understand. And so what they're going to do, by the way, is try to manipulate control to get what I have. So I have anointing from God, which people respect me for that. And I know that. And let me, I'll clarify it in a moment. And I have resources. I have great resources at Gateway Church. Millions of dollars that we can give at any point. And then God gave me personally great resources through the books that I have. And why wouldn't you give a giver a lot of money? And I don't do book tours. I don't hawk my books. I don't do any of that stuff. I just write them and they just sell. It's just shocking. Matter of fact, Chris Kane was in our home a while back. Nick and Chris. Chris was speaking somewhere. We saw Nick at a restaurant. We said, hey, you guys come over, visit if you have time. They came over. Chris said, hey, I want to ask you a question. And she didn't realize how it came out. I mean, she's a wonderful person, obviously. Been here many, many times. But she said, why in the world do your books sell so much? And I thought, I don't know either, because they're horrible. I don't know why they, you know. But millions and millions of copies, and so such a degree that many times I'm donating the equivalency of my salary, but I'm working for free at Gateway Church many times because God has given me these great resources. Why? Because I'll steward them. He knows that. He knows I'll steward them. And then he's given me influence. Pastor Jack Hayford helped me with this tremendously. I don't think I'm better than anyone else because people know me or recognize me, but what I do know is that I have influence and I need to use that influence correctly for the kingdom of God. I asked Pastor Jack, because I get, I don't know, Mike would probably know, I don't know where Mike went. I don't know how many requests I get to endorse books. Lots. Every week, because when you put on the cover, forward by Robert Morris, you know it, and I've sold so many books, then it's like, here's a stamp of approval, you know. But I asked Pastor Jack when I started getting so many requests, I said, Pastor Jack, how do you decide which books to endorse and which books not to endorse? Here's what he said to me. He said, I don't endorse books. And I remember thinking, well, I've seen a whole bunch of books, you know, endorsed by Pastor Jack. So I said, well, what do you mean you don't endorse books? He said, I endorse people. He said, because they can write a good book and you endorse them and the next book is off the wall. And it's crazy, but you put your name on them. So he said, I only endorse people. So when I've done that for her, we had some people on our staff write books, and the staff for a while was like, Pastor Robert, you know, it's the staff, so you know how to endorse them. And then the next book they write is, you know, like they're on dope or something. I mean, just so. I'm not prideful about the resources and the influence and the anointing God's given me, but I'm sober about it, and I will steward it. And I will not give it to someone else if I don't believe that person will steward it also. So the reason he attacks these leaders is because they have this. Now, they operate through this spirit is a manipulating, controlling spirit. Jezebel manipulated to get Naboth's vineyard. Do you remember that? So I'm just trying to quote some scripture to help you understand. And the reason they manipulate and control is because they really truly don't believe that God will give them what God wants to give them and that they have to work for everything they get. And I don't care whether I'm a welder in East Texas. I really don't. If God wants me to pastor Gateway Church, I'll pastor Gateway Church. But if he wants me to retire and have a horse farm, I'm going to do that too. Because I want to do what God wants me to do. And so I don't care about you know, the resources of the fame have come with more problems than you can imagine. And I know some of you say, well, I'd like to try. But believe me, there's a responsibility that comes with the greater resources and the greater influence that you have in the kingdom of God. These people covet the anointing and the resources and the influence that you have. One of the signposts of a person who could have an open door to a Jezebel spirit is position and title are very important to them. I mean, I literally had a person who would not come to work for me without a certain title. I said, I feel like the title should be this. He said, I won't do that. I have to have this title. And it should have been a red flag right then. What I'm teaching you is from Scripture and the mistakes I've made. And I say, well, yeah, I'll give him the title because surely he'll never misuse the title. Then he does. So anybody who the position and title are important. The people I have around me now, they don't care what their title is. They don't give a flip what their title is. They say, I'm just here to serve, Pastor Robert. Whatever you want me to do. By the way, the other people say the same thing. I'm just here to serve you. But there's a different spirit behind it. And you've got to learn to recognize that spirit. So here's number three. When does the Jezebel spirit attack? Well, actually, I have something else, but I wanted to go ahead and just say the funny part that I wrote this later in my point. But I'm just going to say this, and some of you will really, you'll just love this. When does the Jezebel spirit attack? When you plant a church. They come out of the woodwork. Where's Preston and Tim? They come out of the woodwork, don't they? I see your smile. They come out of the woodwork. But you know why? Because they know they can't get a position at Gateway Church. So maybe they can get a position at a new Gateway Church. Because when you're starting a church, you're looking for volunteers that can fog a mirror. That is the only qualification. Are you breathing? You're hired. You can volunteer. We love you, brother. Come on in. Okay. And it's like Yahoo or Google or whatever. They want to get in on the ground floor. And they want to be your best friend so that one day they have a whole bunch of respect. So let me give you what I had actually written as the first part of that. When does the Jezebel spirit attack? Probably after a great victory. So you might not be a church planter, but you have a great victory, and the Jezebel spirit sees the power and the anointing like after Mount Carmel, and the spirit attacks. That's when the spirit attacks. Let me say it another way, too, when you're tired. I mean, Elijah had just killed 850 prophets. I think that would make you tired, you know, cutting their heads off. I mean, yeah, okay, come on, bend over, you know. I mean, it would make you tired killing that many people. And then the mental and the emotional and the spiritual energy it took to call fire down from heaven. And then the enemy attacks. So here at number four, from where does the attack come? From where does the attack come? Now, this also could be a surprise to you. From a friend. It comes someone who is already your friend or is trying to be your friend. You need to be very, very careful of people who want to be your friend. Now, I have some friends that are tried and tested and true. But I've had people who I thought were my friends, and yet they had warning signs that I should have seen. And what I did was I allowed it. I allowed unchristlikeness in their lives and I should have called him on it. And it now it's a warning sign to me. When I talked about the four foundations, one of the guys that this Jezebel spirit, manifested in, he wasn't a worshiper. I watched him. He was a pastor of a church and not a worshiper. And a worshiper abandons himself before God. A guy that's really anointed is a guy that'll do a crazy dance like David, no matter what anybody thinks. He's abandoned to God. Now, not everybody worships the same. But boy, when you see someone who's not a worshiper, or the other one we talked about was humility. Remember we talked about the four foundations? When you see someone's not humble, you stay away from him, because he'll turn on you. So it'll come from a friend or someone trying to be your friend. Now, because I'm saying this, let me bring out a very important distinction. The first time I dealt with a Jezebel spirit, Pastor Jack Hayford helped me. And I said, Pastor Jack, I don't know how to deal with this because this is a friend. And he said to me, Robert, you can be gracious with the person, but you cannot be gracious with the spirit. You get the spirit out. You give the person a chance to repent. Jesus said, I gave her time to repent. Do you know he loved? Listen to me, this is going to shock you. Do you know Jesus loved Jezebel, the person? He hated the spirit. But he loved the person. He wanted that woman to repent. He loved her. So you can be gracious with the person. So I tried and tried and tried to help. The people that have had this spirit, I've tried to talk to them. I've tried to help them in areas. But eventually, when they won't be helped, I can't let the church suffer. And I will put them out. I'll get them out. Of the same way you get a wolf away from the sheep. And by the way, you'll be held accountable. You will be held accountable. I wonder if I got that scripture on this point. No, I got it under another point. I don't know if there's any way they can come to that point. Wonder where I have that point, that scripture. Oh, okay, I got it later, so we'll just get to it. But you'll be held accountable, so. By the way, every time I've dealt with a Jezebel spirit, I've come out more anointed. And I guess it was a new song tonight that the guy was singing, What the Devil Meant for Evil, Satan, God Has Turned for Good. Because I looked up on the words to see who wrote the song, and there weren't any words. And I just want you to know, what the devil means for evil, God will turn for good. The other thing I want to say is that the person is a very insecure person and actually loves you and wants acceptance from you. But the spirit hates you. The person loves you, but the spirit wants to kill you. And I am living proof. I am living proof that the spirit has tried to kill me. There's no doubt in my mind what I went through 3.5 years ago was a Jezebel spirit trying to kill me. There's no doubt in my mind. So he wants to kill you. He tried to kill Elijah. So we'll get to all that. Let me see what else. Okay, so what's the open door? I said rejection, insecurity, inferiority. Most of the time, in my experience, the person has either a neglectful parent or a controlling parent. Let me say it another word. Most of the people that I've dealt with that have the Jezebel spirit have a father wound. Now, I'm going to, this is the open door where the enemy comes in. I'm going to give you an example from Scripture that might ruin one of your sermons, just so you know. I don't think Jonathan and David is a good example of friendship and covenant. Just study it a little bit deeper. Jonathan caused David to vow. And look at it in the Hebrew and read some Hebrew scholars about it. He forced him to make a covenant. And the covenant was, you'll take care of me and my family. The tradition was when a new family came into rule, when it wasn't a biological, that the new king killed all of the descendants. I think Jonathan was playing both ends. In other words, if Saul killed David, then he'd be the heir. But if David killed Saul, he'd be David's best friend. And I really did, it's been a long time since I studied it, and I didn't have time preparing for the conference, but I think there were five times that Saul went exact right to where David was, and three of the times there was only one person that knew where he was. Jonathan. And if you want to know if Jonathan had a father wound, let me read you the passage. 1 Samuel 20, verse 27, it happened the next day, the second day of the month, and David's place was empty at the table. And Saul said to Jonathan, his son, why has the son of Jesse not come to eat either yesterday or today? So Jonathan answered Saul, David earnestly asked permission of me to go to Bethlehem. By the way, that was a lie. So he's lying. And he said, please let me go, for our family has sacrificed in the city. My brother has commanded me to be there. And now if I found favor in your eyes, please let me get away and see my brothers. Therefore, he has not come to the king's table. Then Saul's anger was aroused against Jonathan. Now remember, this is a banquet where a lot of people are around. And he said to him, you son of a perverse, rebellious woman. Let me read that to you in the New Living Translation. Saul boiled with rage and said, you stupid son of a whore. So if you've never had any counseling training, that's a father wound. When your father calls you, you stupid son of a whore, that's a father wound. And then here's the main reason that I have suspicions about Jonathan. Just a few chapters later, Jonathan says to David, and he said to him, do not fear, for the hand of Saul, my father, shall not find you. You shall be king over Israel, and I shall be next to you. I know I'm not going to be number one, but I'm going to be number two. See, if you can't be the king, the next best thing is be the king's best friend. You better watch your people try to be your best friend. You better know, are they doing it really to serve Jesus? Or are they doing it so they can get a higher position? And they know they can't get that position on their own, so they want to be next to you. They want to be the number two guy. So here's number five. How is the attack going to manifest? And now I have 7 points under here, and I put them all in parentheses. I know correct outlining, you're supposed to put letters, but I just did numbers. So if grammatically this bothers you, just get over it. All right. So number one is fear. 1 Kings 19, Ahab told Jezebel all that Elijah had done, also how he had executed all the prophets with the sword. Then Jezebel sent a messenger to Elijah saying, so let the gods do to me and more also, if I do not make your life as the life of one of them by tomorrow about this time. And when he, Elijah, saw that, he arose and ran for his life. Elijah. He stopped heaven from raining for 3.5 years. He called fire down from heaven. And he runs from a person who makes this threat against him. He runs for his life. Fear. When you start feeling fear, it's possible there's a Jezebel spirit attacking you. Why didn't he go right up to Jezebel that day and say, go ahead. You want to come against me? I'll call fire down on you and burn you to a crisp. Or like my successor is going to do Elisha, I'll call two she-bears out of the wood and they'll chew you up, you know. Why did he run for his life? Fear. Elijah. I mean, if Elijah had fear, you think some of us might have fear when this spirit comes? By the way, when the Lord showed me this spirit, I was in the green room one time. I was at the old building, and I was praying over the service, and I started taking authority over the Jezebel spirit. And this thought came in my mind, you better not address this spirit. This is a strong spirit. You don't want to rile this spirit up. And it's like fear came in the room. And then the Lord said to me, I'm stronger than this spirit. You tell this spirit to get out, and you just say, in Jesus' name. You realize in Jesus' name is like saying boo to a demon. Boo in Jesus' name. And if you say, well, I'm still just a little concerned about addressing spirit, then do what Michael and Zechariah did. Say, the Lord rebuke you. The Lord rebuke you, Jezebel spirit, over my church. So number one is fear, the way he attacks. This is all under point five. Number two is depression. If you feel depressed, you may be under attack of a Jezebel spirit. 1 Kings 19:4, but he himself went a day's journey into the wilderness and came and sat down under a broom tree, and he prayed that he might die. That's Elijah. And said, it is enough. Now, Lord, take my life. I'm no better than my father's. When you have serious thoughts, now listen to me carefully. When you've had suicidal thoughts, it's probably a Jezebel spirit attacking you. When you read the obituaries and you see that a guy died and you think, well, at least he can rest now. And you think, praise the Lord, I hope I get to rest one day. That's the Jezebel spirit. When you're not excited about life, it's a Jezebel spirit. Third way that he'll attack you is fatigue. Then he, verse 5, then as he lay down, this is Elijah again, and slept under a broom tree, suddenly an angel touched him and said, arise and eat. He looked, and there by his head was a cake baked on coals and a jar of water. So he ate and drank and lay down again, took another nap. So here, let me just tell you, if you're being attacked by a Jezebel spirit, here's what you need to do. Take a nap and eat cake. That's what the Bible says. The Bible, next time when your spouse says, you gonna have another piece of cake? The Bible says. By the way, I think this is the first mention of angel food cake in the I know it's corny, but it's funny still. If you don't think it is, just don't say anything. All right, so number four way he'll attack you, sickness. Revelation 2:22, indeed I will cast her into a sick bed and those who commit adultery with her into great tribulation until they repent of their deeds. So let me say this, frequent and unusual sicknesses and frequent and unusual accidents. I think it shows there's a Jezebel spirit at work. Number five, immorality. Revelation 2:20, nevertheless, I have a few things against you because you allow the woman Jezebel, who calls herself a prophetess, to teach and seduce my servants to commit sexual immorality. And then we need this other part for the next point, and eat things sacrificed to idols, which the next point would be idolatry. We'll get to that. But I just didn't want to read the verse again. Greater sexual temptation could mean you're being attacked by a Jezebel spirit. I remember about 5 years in the church when I started being attacked by a Jezebel spirit. I told Debbie, I told some spiritual mentors, I told the elders, I'm having sexual dreams. And I'm having sexual temptation that I haven't dealt with in years. And I didn't realize it at the time. I look back on it now. And if you're having greater sexual temptation, you need to pray and see, is there a Jezebel spirit close to me in somebody? Remember, you can be gracious with the person. You can't be gracious with the spirit. Number six is idolatry, and the scripture is still Luke 2:20 we just read. But let me tell you what idolatry is. It's looking to things to make you happy. And we, you know what we call this for men? We call it a midlife crisis. But I'm telling you, pastors go through this where we just go from one thing to another because we can't find joy in our relationship with Jesus Christ. Number seven is rehearsing your speech. I love this. If you're rehearsing your speech to this person over and over again, it's probably a Jezebel spirit that you're dealing with. 1 Kings 19, verse 9, and then he went into a cave, and he spent the night in that place, and behold, the word of the Lord came to him, and he said to him, what are you doing here, Elijah? So he said, I've been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, for the children of Israel that have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, and killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they now seek to take my life. Then a wind, remember, a great wind, earthquake, fire came, and then a still small voice. Remember? Then after the still small voice, verse 13, so it was when Elijah heard it, the still small voice, that he wrapped his face in his mantle, and he went out and stood at the entrance of the cave. Suddenly a voice came to him saying, what are you doing here, Elijah? And he said, I have been very zealous for the Lord God of hosts, because the children of Israel have forsaken your covenant, torn down your altars, killed your prophets with the sword, and I alone am left, and they seek to take my life. It's the exact same speech. I wonder if you think about this. How many times have you rehearsed the speech of confronting that person? And you rehearse it, and you rehearse it, and you rehearse it. Now, let me give you some wisdom so you'll quit rehearsing this speech. You cannot out-argue a demon. You cannot. And if a person is under the demonic influence of a spirit, he or she will not admit wrong. Because if he admits wrong, then it weakens his case. And then you might have something to be able to, you might be able to get him to admit another thing that he did wrong. I can remember addressing this spirit in a person on our staff that we had to let go. And I had the text. I mean, I had a text that he sent to Mike that Mike forwarded to me. Manipulation. And I said to him, I'm trying to talk to the person to get him to repent. I really want him to repent. But he wouldn't admit one thing that he'd done wrong. So I said to him, you sent Mike this text, and this is manipulation. What he actually did in the text was he said, Tom Lane said. Well, around here, Tom Lane way up there, you know? So when people wanted to get something done, they used to say, Tom Lane said, you know? And then I'd talk to Tom, and Tom say, I didn't say that, you know? But they'd use his name. So this person said, in a text to Mike, Tom Lane told me to say, tell you. Well, it's a lie. So I said to him, you said this. I'm trying to show you that you were telling the truth and you were lying. And he said to me, I don't remember sending that text. So I said to him, here it is. I said, take my phone and read it. He did this right here. Yeah, I just don't remember sending that text. Okay, that's when I'm thinking, okay, I'm dealing with a demon. Because a demon he'll just lie to me. So just stop rehearsing your speech. Try to help the person, but when you figure out they don't want help, let them go. Get them out, cut the relationship off. Because now you're dealing with a demon. By the way, he said, I alone am left. You remember the last verse, God said, "No, I got 7,000 others. You're not the only one, hotshot. I got 7,000 others." So you're also believing a lie. All right, here's last point, number six. What do we do about it? If you're being attacked by a Jezebel spirit, what do we do about it? Revelation 2:20, "Nevertheless, I have a few things against you because you allow that woman Jezebel, who calls herself prophetess, you allow her to teach, seduce, and okay, here's what you do about it. You stop allowing that person to elevate himself or herself in the body. You stop it. You could try to get the person to repent. I have not had success, though, with getting people to repent once that spirit takes over. So you stop it. You fire them. You tell them, we're not going to be friends anymore. You do whatever you have to do. But you cut that thing out of your life. You do not be gracious with the spirit. You be firm-handed with it. And this is what Jesus said. You know what I have against you? Even though your last works are greater than your first, you allow. That's what I have against you. Not against her. I have this against you because you're the leader and you're allowing her to have influence in the church. And the church, by the way, belongs to me, not to you. And so not only am I going to cast her into a sick bed, I'm going to cast everybody that has a relationship with her into great tribulation. And that's including you. And this is where I had the scripture a while ago. I said that, you know, you're going to have to give an account. Hebrews 13:17 says, "Obey your leaders and submit to them." Now, let me just stop for a minute. As leaders, we love that verse. You know, the Bible says to obey your leaders. Here's the part you ought to take notice of, though. "For they are keeping watch over your souls as those who will have to give an account." You're going to have to give an account if you let a Jezebel have authority in your church. And you're going to have to give an account to the person that said, "I will build my church. This is my church." Don't ever say "my sheep," because they're not your sheep. They're his sheep. He's the chief shepherd. You're the under shepherd. Then he told him to focus on the next generation. Joachim helped us with that today. He said, "Anoint Hazael king over Syria, anoint Jehu king over Israel, and anoint Elisha prophet." King over Israel, to me, I'm going to take a little license here, because it's Israel, that'd be priest. So here's what he said: focus on raising up prophets, priests, and kings. That's just free. You can use that in a sermon, okay? Focus on raising up prophets, priests, and kings. Focus on the next generation. In other words, don't quit, but finish the race. So let me just give you a story here. I've dealt strongly with the Jezebel spirit twice now, very strongly, through friends. They were friends. And the first time I did, I remember just going to the shore of a lake and praying when I realized I'm dealing with a spirit, because I have talked and talked and talked till I'm blue in the face with this person. This is a spirit. And Pastor Jack told me this is a spirit, Pastor Jack Hayford. And so I went to the shore of a lake and I was praying, and you know, and then all of a sudden I just felt like the Lord said, "You need to pray over this until it's done." And so I started praying, "Lord, I just pray you'll help me." Da, da. And I just happened to glance. I had the truck running, whatever I was driving then. I think it was a truck. But I had it running, and because it was cold, and so I had the heater going, you know, parked on the shore of the lake. I just happened to glance at the clock, and let's say it was 11 o'clock. I don't remember the exact time. But I started praying. Well, all of a sudden, I began to repent. This is the first thing to do, by the way, is to repent for allowing this person, this spirit, to operate. And I began to repent and say, God, I'm so sorry. They're your sheep. They're not mine, they're yours. And I repent. And then I began to take authority over this spirit. And then I began to break curses spoken over me and over my family and over our church because of this spirit, that the spirit was saying through this person. And then I began to tell that spirit to go. Now, while I was doing this, I happened to look out the window, and I don't know if there were some fish on the shore or what, but there were buzzards circling. And I'm not one of those, you know, spooky guys, but sometimes just things happen and you just think, that's pretty amazing. And I'm telling this spirit, you're going, you're leaving. You're leaving Gateway Church. You're not allowed here anymore. I'm the angel over Gateway Church. I'm the senior pastor. And I'm telling you in Jesus' name, you get out of here. These buzzards that have been circling for about 15 minutes turned and took off like that. I mean, they just took off. And I started saying to him, yeah, you keep going. You know, you just keep on going. But then I started shouting, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. And I don't know how long that lasted, but I knew it was done in the spirit. I still had to meet with the person and release that person from authority in our church and off our staff. But it was done in the spirit. And I remember looking at the clock and it was exactly 1 hour. It'd been 1 hour of prayer. The greatest joy I've ever had is when I've gone through something like this and I've dealt with it. You can't imagine, even though I've had this person, when I dealt with this person, he just got up and stormed out of the restaurant. But when I went out and got in my car, I shouted hallelujah. Hallelujah. I don't have to deal with that anymore. Hallelujah. The last time I had to deal with a person, he chewed me out. We had a 55-minute phone conversation. He talked 50 minutes. He chewed me out. He said everything in the book to me. And then here's what he said. Well, I guess I just need to leave the church. And what they're doing is they're threatening you. And let me just say what to do when someone threatens you. Call their bluff. And I said, I guess you do. Like that. And so he said, well, I guess it's done then. And I said, yeah, it's done. And we hung up. When we hung up, I started shouting, hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Because the spirit's gone. Now, let me tell you something. I still love the person. And I pray for the person. But I will not, as long as I stand in this place, I will not allow a spirit to come amongst the sheep. I will not allow it. We're going to pray and take authority because I'm going to ask everyone to stand. You want to know why? Because either a Jezebel spirit's coming after you and your church right now, or has, or will. One or the other. And we're going to repent if we've allowed it, and then we're going to tell it to go. All right? So will you stand up? I want you to remember that Jesus loves the people. Josh, my son, preached a message a couple weeks ago about the Ninevites and the Assyrians that were taking over Nineveh. And he said, this is one of the greatest comments, you know, I've ever heard from the pulpit. He said, it's okay to share in God's anger for the wickedness as long as you share in his love for the people, which is what Jonah, remember, didn't want. Okay, so we're not going to be gracious with the spirit, but I want you to retain a good heart. toward the person. Don't get eaten up with anger and bitterness, because that's exactly what this spirit wants, all right? So the first thing I want you to do is just close your eyes and just ask the Holy Spirit. Holy Spirit, is there any spirit? Maybe it's not even a Jezebel spirit. Maybe it's just a spirit of division or whatever in your marriage, your family, with a teenager, a child. Is there a demonic spirit that's coming against me or my house or my church or the church, I should say. When I say my, you know what I mean? The church where I serve. Just ask the Lord, is it a spirit that's motivating this person? And let the Lord deal with you so that you can say truly, I love the person, but I'm not gonna allow this spirit anymore. So just ask the Lord. And if the Lord shows you, then will you just repent for allowing this spirit to have some sort of elevation or power or control in the place where you have authority, where God's given you responsibility. So just take a moment. I might even keep just talking to give you just here, but you can go ahead and talk to the Lord and just tell him, Lord, I ask you to forgive me. You might have said, Lord, I ask you to forgive me for thinking, well, this is just the way teenagers are, instead of going to war for my son right now who's going through a battle, or my daughter who's going through a battle. Whatever you need to repent for, just tell him, Lord, I repent. I'm going to go to war. I am going to war. I'm not going to let this spirit have my child. I'm not going to let this spirit have my job. I'm not going to let this spirit have the church where you called me to minister. I'm not going to do it. I'm not quitting. Like Elijah said, Lord, just kill me. And the Lord said, no, I'm not killing you. I need you to start raising up the next generation. So you just tell the Lord whatever you need to tell him, all right? And Lord, I want to come into agreement with my brothers and sisters right now. And I think about these letters that you wrote to the messengers of these churches. And Lord, as leaders, we repent. We change our minds about being manipulated and being controlled by people. And Lord, we want the only person to be in charge of our lives to be you. We serve you. And we don't want to allow any other person to be in charge of us. Lord, we submit to godly authority on this earth. But when it's manipulative and controlling, then Lord, we don't want to tolerate it anymore. We don't want to allow this spirit to elevate itself in the body. And so, Holy Spirit, we come and we say, thank you for convicting us. And we ask you to forgive us. We receive the blood of Jesus as atonement for these sins. And then, Lord, it says submit to God and resist the enemy. Because, God, now we have submitted to you first, we resist Satan in Jesus' name. We resist the Jezebel spirit, and we rebuke the Jezebel spirit, and we declare to you, the Lord rebuke you. The Lord rebuke you. I rebuke every spirit of fear and insecurity and inferiority and rejection and manipulation and control and sickness and immorality and idolatry in Jesus' name. I rebuke you and I command you to go and I cast you out right now in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name, I command you to go in Jesus' name. You have no place of authority in our lives or in our churches. And I break and sever every word, curse, and spell spoken against us and spoken against our marriages and spoken against our families and spoken against our children and spoken against our churches that where we pastor. I break and sever every word, every curse, every spell, every plan, every demonic scheme against the church of the living God. And Lord, we receive your power, your anointing, your forgiveness, your deliverance in Jesus' name. Amen and amen. Hallelujah and hallelujah and hallelujah, Lord. Hallelujah.